Cool. How you guys doing?
Good.
Cool. Who here's excited about life?
Me.
Somewhat. Thank you, Lord. Good to see my brother Micah here. Just saying.
Hey, Micah.
Looking good this morning. I was wandering around and a couple kids in the nursery, and then Frankie's got like more people and more kids in her kids' class than we have in here this morning. She's got this whole little other church going on across the hall there, so pretty cool. Thank you, Lord. Well, Father, I just thank you for your word this morning, and I thank you for the power, the authority of your word. And Lord, your word planted in our hearts causes us to be a new creation and in Christ Jesus. And I just thank you for the reality of the new creation that's forming inside of us, that's changing us, transforming us from the inside out, that's causing us supernaturally to love people because of your love inside of us, God. It's your love, it's your truth that changes societies, that releases the kingdom of God. And so we just thank you for that in Jesus' name this morning. And I just thank you, Lord, for everybody at different churches and all the churches in this city. We say over our city and over our county, let your kingdom come.
Yes.
Let your will be done.
Yes.
On earth as it is in heaven. I just thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Okay, why is there a pillow in here?
Because the Lord gives his beloved rest.
There you go, Tim. Whoa. Just flew by his hands.
Right in the face.
All right.
I did that as well.
Go to sleep.
So, I was thinking and praying about this morning, and I feel there's a challenge. I feel there's a call that God is calling, and He's speaking this morning that to some of us today is a new day. That for some of us we need to lay down everything before Him afresh, and take up His mantle on our lives. And for others of us. He may be speaking this as well, but he's putting his hand on some of us and saying, now is the time that I'm calling you into a place of leadership, and I'm calling you into a place of influence. And you may be afraid, and you may be thinking, you may have vacillated for years, but God is calling you into a place of leadership, and he's calling you into a place of influence, and he's calling you into a place of fruitfulness. And so, whenever, you know, preaching is one of those things for me where it's always a mystery how God gets it done. But who knows, like, if you read the Bible, God says a lot to a lot of people in a lot of ages in the world and throughout history. I mean, this book represents 8,000 years plus of God speaking to the nations, God speaking to the world. So the question always is, on Sunday morning or any time, what is God saying now? Amen. I want to know what God is speaking right now in this moment. What's he saying to us? What's he saying to us as a church? What is he saying individually to each one of us? And so I want to know, for me, every day I want to know, God, what are you speaking to me today? Come on, amen. Who here wants to wake up in the morning and say, hey God, what are you saying to me today? Because if I can hear that word, it will bring clarity. So many times, so one of the things that people ask me is they're confused about life. And so the encouragement always is, well, what's God saying? Because if you can find out what God's saying, you won't be confused anymore. And that's, to me, that's the purpose of prayer. Prayer crystallizes in my spirit and then in my mind what God is saying to me so that I can have vision, so that I'm not wandering around just kind of bumping along in life, that I have a vision, I have a purpose, I'm driving forward into something that's bigger than myself, right? The Bible says, without a vision, the people cast off restraint. They perish, they don't know where they're going, but when you can begin to hear from God, so I want to hear from God for myself, I want to hear from God for my family. I want to hear from God regarding my church, I want to hear from God regarding my business. I don't want to just keep doing something, I want to hear from God. And so this morning we want to hear what God is saying, and God, what are you saying? And I sense God is saying this: get ready. Become the strong man, woman, of the word and prayer that I'm calling you to be, because I'm getting ready for harvest. That's what I feel like he's saying. And I feel like he's saying this all over the world, but he's saying that to us. He's saying, it's time to become strong. Stronger than you've ever been before. You know, there's something about embracing weakness, and we sing about it, and there's something, you know, there's a brokenness in life and all of that, and that's real. But there's a certain point in time where God says, okay, I want you to lay aside that brokenness and I want you to get strong. We're going to read about that this morning. God has strength for you. Amen? Yes. He wants you to be strong. He wants you to be focused. And so let's get into this. Let's go to John chapter 14 this morning. The Gospel of John chapter 14. As an aside, I personally believe, you know, a lot of people, I've heard this since I was 16 years old, 20 years I've known Jesus, and I've heard for the last 20 years that Jesus is coming soon, and I believe that. I think you got to put it in perspective. I think that the Apostle Paul believed that Jesus was coming any moment, and I think throughout the ages, every century, people have believed that Jesus is coming any moment. And we believe that this possibly could be the end times. I remember when I was, when Davina was first born, and I was just praying over her, and she's, you know, when you have your first baby, you're always like just so scared. No, you're concerned, but you're scared. You're scared. I think scared is the right word. You don't want anything to happen to them. So like 20 times a night, you're checking, are they breathing? Are they breathing? Are they breathing? Yeah, let's say you're a little feathered or whatever, that you're just make sure there's breath coming in and out of their nostril, right? Does this make sense to anybody? I remember one time, I think Davina was 2 days old and she was sleeping in between us, and Carly, we woke up in the night because Carly was using her as a pillow. Remember that? And we're like freaked out, like, is she okay? Is she okay? And so I was praying. We're like, let's not do that again. Because she was so tired from the birth and all of that. But I was praying over Davina, maybe a couple, like she was maybe a week old. I was just saying, God, I just want you to protect my baby. And I was probably crying like I always do. And I was just praying over her, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me so clearly and said, son, my hand is on your daughter. She's going to be a mother. She's going to be a grandmother. And you are going to see like the fruitfulness of your posterity. And he just gave me this promise, and I felt the power of the Holy Ghost over my Davina. And he made these promises to me. And so it's just got me thinking, God, you have a lot for our kids. You have a lot for our generation. Like you may be coming soon, but I think you have a lot for the church. You have a glorious bride that you want to rise up in the nations of the world and display the splendor of Jesus all over the world. I mean, I think that I was just at a conference, and somebody said, someone of the preachers there said, and he was a very anointed man of God, is one of the, he does a Bethel church in Ohio. I forget his name, but about 1,000 people, and just an awesome, awesome man. And he felt like the Holy Spirit, he said, I just submit this to you, but he said, I feel like the Holy Spirit said to me that the return of Christ isn't for maybe 500 years or something like that. Like, I think so often we think it's just around the corner, and if I could just hold on and just hold on and just hold on, then maybe I can see the rapture or something like that. And I think that might be the wrong mindset for some of us. Like, God wants to actually save people in this day and age. He actually wants to build the church. He doesn't just want us to hold on for dear life. He wants to make us strong and cause us to be an overcomer in our generation. something cool, Danica, is I'm actually moving the pastor who's coming to start a Love First church. I don't know if you know that. So I'm moving him the beginning of July. And you guys know that a church that comes up from Atlanta every year. They're actually starting a congregation, so I get to move the pastor here. And they're gonna do a huge, it's the 10th anniversary of them coming to Kathleen Street. They're gonna do a huge blowout. And I'm like, and I told the pastor, I'm like, I would love to be a part of it. Let's partner together. Yeah, they seems like a really cool couple. Anyway, let's partner together for the harvest, because you want to save Kathleen Street, you want to save every street. But God is moving, and He wants to move, and He's sending up. There's another church starting. I'm like, praise the Lord, that's awesome. I wish that 50 more churches would start, because it's, you know, I wish that every one of us in here would start a small group and begin, like Mark said, to win people to Jesus and get a heart for the lost and a heart for the harvest, right? And so, what am I saying here? Luke, John chapter 14, is that where we are?
Yes.
Let's go to verse 1. Let not your hearts be troubled, Jesus speaking. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. Some of your translations might say many mansions. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, that you, that where I am, you may also be. And you know the way to where I am going. And so Jesus, very obviously speaking about heaven, speaking about the afterlife, and saying, hey guys, I'm not going to leave you here, but you got some work to do before that happens. Verse 5, Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? And the words I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or else believe on account of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, look at this, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. Wow.
Yep.
Someone say wow. I mean, what a promise. I mean, I think that we need to begin to exercise the authority of the name of Jesus over our lives, over the people we know. 2 days ago, I was working, and one of my summer student employees, his shoulder was hurting, and I'm like, it's kind of normal. We dropped a couch, kind of didn't drop it, we just twisted it a little bit, and he twisted his shoulder. And I said, he's like, oh, my shoulder. And I'm like, oh, man, what's going on? And he's like, well, I got 3 pins in it from a surgery from, you know, a year and a half ago. I'm like, you're only 19 and you only have a surgery in your shoulder. And I just felt like just this thing in me, just pray for him. Pray for healing for him. And I was kind of like, we're working and it's the end of the day and we're almost done. I'm like, well, Lord, I don't know. And then I just thought, what do you have to lose, right? So I'm like, man, I'm going to pray for you. He's a good Catholic kid, right? Doesn't know Jesus, but he's a good Catholic kid. And so I said, I'm going to pray for you. And he's just right away. good kid, James.
Yeah.
Invite him out. And so I just started praying. I tell you, the Holy Ghost just came. The power of the Holy Spirit just came. And he goes, my arm is tingling. What is this? It's tingling. I'm like, man, that's the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
He's healing you.
Yeah.
And it must be tendons or something, because your shoulder should be tingling right now. Maybe, I don't know what's going on. So he came back the next day and he's like, my shoulder feels better.
Come on.
Like, that's the healing presence of God.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if it's 100%, but he received a healing or a measure of healing, and he felt the power of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
I think that we need to begin to ask more of Jesus in his name as we see need. Okay, verse 15. If you love me, Jesus speaking, you will obey, or you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. People sometimes have asked me, how do you know that this Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life? And I'm like, because the Spirit of truth, he's told me. When you experience the Spirit of truth, you just know that Jesus is the truth. You just know it. You know, people ask me, oh, this book was written by how many different men over the ages? How do you know it's veracity? How do you know that it's the Word of God? I mean, come on. There's lots of other books. There's lots of other things. It could have been changed. Why these books? Why have they canonized these books? Why this Bible? I just know. The Spirit of truth has told me. Anyone ever experienced that before? You just know that you know that you know that you know. Because the Spirit of truth. He is the Spirit of truth. He doesn't lie. He always tells the truth. Even when you don't want to hear it, he tells the truth.
That's right.
And the blessing of the Lord, man, even when, I don't know if any men have experienced this, but even if you're ignoring the Spirit of truth, you still got your wife to tell you the truth. Anybody ever experienced that before? Vaughn's looking at me cross-eyed right now. Oh, Jesus. That's the blessing of having a woman of God as your wife, is that even if you're ignoring the truth, Mark, she'll tell you the truth. That's a good word. Verse 18, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. But a little while, and the world will see me no more. But you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. My goodness gracious. In that day, you will know that I'm in the Father, and you in me, and I in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest or reveal myself to him. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and the Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. You know, I often used to ask God, I've asked him probably, well, many, many times, especially in the earlier days, I said, God, it feels mean that you say these words. Because, I mean, you love the world, but why do you demand obedience? And it was a little while that the Holy Spirit began to reveal to me, son, because I am love. I'm love. Therefore, every word that I speak is love. It's from a heart of love. So if you keep my words, you're actually loving me. If you keep my word, you're operating out of a spirit of love, out of the Spirit of God, rather than some other spirit or selfishness. And so, anyway, let's verse 25, we're almost done here. These things, done with this portion of scripture, we got one more. These things I've spoken to you while I'm still with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I've said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away and I will come to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced, because I am going to the Father. The Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before, it takes place so that when it does take place, you may believe. I will no longer talk with you much, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no claim on me, or he has no place in me. But I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father. Rise, let's go from here. I am the true vine, verse 15, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I've spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself, unless it abides in the vine, neither can you, unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me, and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. We were singing about that today, right? We want to abide in him. We want to know him more so that we can actually bear fruit. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. Just as an aside, a lot of people have thought that meant hell, and I believe there's a deep revelation in it, but I believe that God is speaking in verse 6 and saying, it's not hell. It means that if the parts that you don't submit to me, those parts will be tested by fire. Those parts, and some of us have experienced this in our lives before, when we haven't submitted our lives to the Lordship of Jesus in areas, then those areas, God allows them to be tested. God allows them to be burned so that we can hopefully come, do a full circle, come back to him, repent, and be fruitful in those areas. Does that make sense? Verse 7, if you abide in me, look at this, my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be followers of Jesus. What's the proof of being a follower of Jesus? Fruit. Someone say fruit.
Fruit.
What is fruit?
Obedience.
Come on, what is it?
Obedience.
Obedience.
Love.
What is fruit? I'm going to tell you, disciples. What is fruit? It's lives. Listen carefully. Being impacted by your life. That's what it is. It's works. Some people have thought that Jesus was talking about the fruit of the Spirit here. But he's not talking about the fruit of the Spirit, because he says, if you abide in me, my words abide in you. Ask whatever you wish. By this, my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. And he says, apart from me, you can do. What's do? It's an action. It's momentum. It's working. It's preaching. It's sharing. It's face-to-face, one-on-one ministry. The fruit of the Spirit is a different topic. It's a different... God wants to give us the fruit of the Spirit, believe you me. But he wants us to bear fruit. And the way that us as a church is going to glorify God in this next season is by bearing fruit. Bearing fruit. Not just holding on for Jesus to come, but bearing fruit. That's what he's calling us to. There's a scripture where I was at that conference and God gave me a personal revelation, and we were one of the preachers was talking about how the widow brought, remember this miracle where there was a famine in the land, and the widow would make a place for the man of God. So God sent the man of God to the widow to save her and her son. Remember the scripture? The widow gave the bread and the water to the man of God, and then he said, gather jars. Gather as many vessels as you can. And so she gathered as many vessels, and the oil poured out, and oil was a precious commodity.
Right.
And so the oil poured out, and as soon as they stopped bringing vessels, what happened?
The oil
stopped pouring. Mm-hmm. And God spoke to me and said, there's something about when there's, I tell you, when there's like new people in church, I can feel it as a preacher. I can feel there's a heightened anointing. There's something there where God just begins to pour out even more because there's new vessels. I'm just telling you, there's something about bringing vessels to God and saying, God, touch them. Fill them. Do something. Amen. And I just felt like God said, you know, you gotta bring, this is the power of bringing people to a place where God is pouring out his Spirit. is that God will actually touch them. There's a greater chance that God will actually minister and pour His Spirit out on them. As the Father has loved me, verse 9, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in His love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. Okay, a little bit more. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. Jesus talked about himself. He's like, I'm about to do this. You are my friends. If you do whatever I command you, no longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, that you love one another. These things I command you, that you love one another. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 12, just for a moment. We're going to close up here. Hebrews chapter 12. Am I doing something wrong? Is there a... Okay, cool. Thank you, James. I want to revisit for a moment the problem with this preaching is that when you surrender to the Lordship of Jesus. I mean, sometimes we read these verses and we don't realize the price that the disciples paid to hear these words. I mean, this was about 3 years of following Jesus. This was right before Jesus was all, everything went down with the cross and the crucifixion. Perhaps days or weeks before. And we hear these words and we're like, yeah, fruit, let's do it. But oftentimes we don't associate or we don't understand that there's a price. No greater love that has anyone than this, than he who lays down his life. What does that mean? It means you sacrifice time, you sacrifice money, you may sacrifice reputation. You may sacrifice friendships. You may sacrifice relationships. It means you give your life. No greater love has anyone than this, than he lays down his life for his friends. So sometimes we read this, you're like, God, make me fruitful. And then he's like, yeah, I don't know, you're not ready yet. You're not there yet. I mean, we could be a little bit fruitful, do a couple things and set up some chairs at church, and that's all good. We need everything we can get. God, I believe God's doing everything He can with everything that we're giving Him in our lives, in our city. But revisiting the problem with this is that, well, let's just read it. Chapter 12. And I just want to give you an assignment to read this week. Hebrews 11 and 12, better to read the whole book. But if you don't have time for the whole book, read 11 and 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely. Let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood, and you have forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons. My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when you are reproved by him. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves, whom he receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline, in which we have all participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they, our earthly fathers, disciplined us for a short time as seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, that we may share his holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Therefore, lift your drooping hands, strengthen your weak knees, make straight paths for your feet, so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. Strive for peace with everyone and for holiness, for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. See that no one fails to obtain the grace of God, that no root of bitterness spring up and causes trouble. By it, many become defiled. See that no one is sexually immoral or unholy like Esau, who sold his birthright for a single meal. For you know that afterward, when he desired to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no chance to repent, though he sought it with tears. And he goes on and says, we have received this kingdom that cannot be shaken. Man, if you read the rest of verse 12, it's going to knock your socks off. This is what I've seen throughout the years, is that God brings people to a church, to a body, where he begins to say, I want you to be fruitful. There's a little honeymoon period where people come to church and they feel God and they get to know God a little bit. But then there's more, and we know that. So if we're not going to get bored with just the Sunday morning touch, God says, okay, now I'll put my hand on you, son. Especially if we say, God, I want to be your disciple. Who's ever said this to him before? I want to be a follower of Jesus. And Jesus says, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. Jesus said, I didn't come to be served, but to serve and to give my life for many. I came to seek and save the lost. That's why he came. So if we're following him, at some point he says, okay, now I'm going to start to raise you up. I'm going to be your dad. I'm going to be your father. I am going to begin to challenge you and chastise you and discipline you like any loving father would. Any loving father would discipline his children. We're growing up right now, or we're growing up, we're living in a generation where there's many young people who have never been disciplined. You may not see it, but I see it. They're weak-willed, they're weak-hearted, because they've never been pushed. This is the most fatherless generation that we've ever lived in the ages. And there's so many young people that are so weak. I'm not saying that's a knock. I'm not saying that to be mean. It's just the truth. We can't even receive a word of correction. You could go on, but you just see it. You see it in this generation. We need to be challenged. But here's what happens. We say, God, raise me up. Raise me up. And then God puts his hand on us and says, okay, Rob, I'm going to begin to raise you up. The challenge with being raised up is that God's going to begin to purify. Mm-hmm. He's going to begin to make holy. Why? So that he can use you. Mm-hmm. He's going to begin to challenge. He's going to begin to prune you so that you may bear more fruit. And often, and this is the challenge, the devil's right there, because he doesn't want, trust me, he's okay. The devil's usually okay with you just coming to a church service, but he's not okay with you rising up and beginning to bear fruit. He doesn't like that, because that's going to ruin his plans, and if we would realize, oftentimes that one word out of a Holy Spirit-filled Christian's mouth can unravel years of the work of the enemy. I mean, that's the power of the Spirit, the power of the blood of Jesus. One word, and that's why the enemy fights so hard to keep your mouth shut as a Christian. He wants to keep your mouth shut. There's so much you could say about, we could get under the spirit of Jezebel and all that stuff. Don't have time. But the enemy's right there saying, Rob, all this going on in your life, if you would just go to Bethel, it would all shift, it would all change. You could actually, you could, that, you know, Josh is what he's talking about. And what begins to happen is because of the discipline, because of the hand of God on our lives, we begin to think, man, this isn't comfortable. I thought church was supposed to be comfortable. I thought this thing was supposed to be squishy. No, man. This place, it's supposed to be a place of equipping for the destiny and for the calling that God has for you.
Yeah.
And God may put his hand on you and say, especially if you say, God, I want to be fruitful. He'll say, but there's a price to that. There's a price to fruit. It's the laying down of your life. And if you start this journey, is anyone tracking with me right now?
Yeah.
I've seen this happen so many times. People leave a church because God puts his hand on them and says, okay, now I'm going to raise you up. And they're confused. In our North American comfort-driven lifestyles, we're confused why there's so much craziness going on the inside of us. But God's actually changing us. He's shifting us. He's saying, okay, I'm moving you from a believer that's just sitting in church once a week to someone who's actually living the life of a disciple. Going out and destroying the works of the enemy on a daily, on a weekly, on a regular basis. Being filled with the spirit of faith and going after what I have for you. Does that make sense? I want to encourage you today. If you ask God to use you, he'll try. He'll try. But don't be deceived into thinking that it's all going to be squishy. It's all going to be nice. You have a Heavenly Father who loves you so much, he'll tell you the truth, and he'll even discipline you when you need it. Isn't that good? He's a good father. He's not always nice. There's a difference between good. Somebody said, he's always good, but he's not nice. There's a difference. Just because you don't think it's nice doesn't mean it's not good. Just because it's not nice. For me, who here grew up getting spanked?
Yeah.
So, all the old people's hands go right up. Carly didn't ever need to be spanked, of course. Did you ever get a spank? Once or twice. Painful in the moment, right? But it shifts you, it changes you, it changes your perspective. Now, if you had a loving father, a good father, he didn't spank you because he didn't love you, because he's mean. He spanked you because he loves you and he wanted to course correct you, right? And that's what God does. He will spank us, but he disciplines us so that we can bear fruit. And I feel like this is a word for many of us, even for many of us watching this and who aren't here in the flesh. But this is a word for some of us. And so when Mark was saying, people were texting him and saying, I'm going to this church, I'm going to that church, I'm going to this church. And my heart goes, cool, at least you're here in church, that's cool. But I just hope that people aren't running from the calling to actually bear fruit. Because I'm telling you, you can hop around church till you go to heaven and not do much for God. You can go to church every week and not do much for God. But when you're a follower of Jesus, he wants to hone you in so that you can hear his voice and know his calling and see people saved and make disciples and have a small group and be a pastor, be an under-shepherd. In fact, that's what God has for every one of us, to be under-shepherds to him and to raise up disciples. Amen? That's what he has for us. Let's stand. Thank you, Lord. So open your hands, open your hearts to Him. I just want to pray over you and pray a blessing over you this morning. But Holy Spirit, I thank you that you are the Spirit of truth. You don't lie to us. You don't deceive us. You just tell us the truth. And so Spirit of God, just I pray that you would right now saturate hearts and minds in your truth. And Lord, that you would challenge every vestige of sin or compromise in our lives. We don't want to compromise. We want to live the life that you've called us to live. We want to live as a disciple, a follower of Jesus. And so Spirit of Truth, just come right now and strengthen hands, strengthen drooping hands, and strengthen knees right now, and that people would, and just all of us right now, would just feel a fresh burst of your strength and your energy inside of us. Strengthen in the Greek means, is the Greek word endunamu. Put that dunamis power on the inside of us, the power of God, the strength of God, even right now. Come on, some of you guys are going to be able to feel strength. I feel the Holy Ghost right now. Somebody just receive it. Some of you are going to feel strength just beginning to well up inside of you. Power. Thank you, Lord. And even this week as we seek you, Lord, I pray that our ears would be attuned to hear your voice. Just like Isaiah said, that you awaken my ear morning by morning to receive fresh truth, to receive strength. Have a word for the weak, a word for the broken. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Stay standing. I just want to speak this over you and encourage you with this last thing. I took some real time on Thursday night and just sought the Lord for about 2 or 3 hours. And this one word that I just felt God speak over and over again to me, he just said to me, "Son, your job is to pray and to obey. My job is to build. Your job is to pray and obey. My job is to build." So I just commission you just to pray. To pray. To be a man. To be a woman of prayer. Seek the Lord. And then as he speaks to you, obey his voice. Because unless the Lord builds the house, the laborers labor in vain. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchmen stay awake in vain. Let's be those who pray and obey and watch the Lord build your life, your house, your family, your church, your business. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Come on, can we give Jesus an awesome hand clap? It's him. Amen. If you would like some prayer, Mark, do you have anything else to say? I'm good. Bless you guys today. Have an awesome week.